This video is all about how to paint watercolour swatches. Now there are a lot of different ways to swatching watercolours, and this will be really useful in your watercolour paintings. Hi, my name is Paul Hopkinson. I'm an online art tutor for painting realistic wildlife, both animals and plants in watercolour. Now please click on subscribe down below, and also press that little bell icon as well. At least when I put a brand new video here on YouTube, you shouldn't miss it. Now the thing is, when you first buy your watercolour paints, is that you really want to get stuck into those colours, don't you? These lovely, bright, kind of glorious colours. However, the colours that you see within the half pans on these two different brands, this is Winsor & Newton, and these are Regina's watercolours. Both are really good quality paints, they really are. But the only thing is, you can't really see the colours properly within either brand, and this applies to a lot of brands I've seen, because they're highly concentrated pigments of paint, aren't they? So really, really thick kind of half pan blocks of paint, which last a long time, brilliant, and that's why I like to buy them, because I'm not one for wasting paint. But when you look at, for example, let's go for this one here, and that's the phthalo blue, and we'll add that onto the corner. Now, when you add this in, a little bit more, you can see straight away, because I've added water to it, look how light that is compared to there. So I can't really go off that colour there, looking at the half pan blocks, when I'm trying to work out a colour that I want. So that's far darker, as you can see, than it is on the paper. The same will apply to Regina's watercolours, for example. So let's go for, so this one down here, let's get a little bit more water actually. These are lovely paints as well, really are. And if I put that on there, look at that lovely colour. However, when you compare that to the half pan, that's much lighter because it's watered down, obviously. That's what I mean. You can't go off just the colours straight from the half pan blocks as when you're trying to work out what colours to use for your main painting. So what I like to do is make what's called a swatch card, a colour swatch card. And all that is a card like this, which I've divided into the same sections I've got within my main selection of paints here, be it for this one or for the Regina's watercolours. And then we can actually look at that rather than looking at this here. Okay, so let's make a start and just quickly put one together. Now to do this, I'm going to make sure I've got equal grids, something similar to that anyway. It doesn't have to be perfect, of course. It's only for colour reference. So what we've got within our mixing colours. So where's my ruler gone? There we go. So I've already marked out some areas on the paper ready to go. And all simply done, by the way. A very easy way of doing it. Really is. I've used probably a centimetre, 1.2 centimetres, something like that. There you go. So 1.2 centimetres roughly. To that point there, to that point there. A little bit of a gap in between. I've used that, just measured it once, and I kind of duplicated a long piece of card. I'll offer it up to my kind of test sheet here, look, and just mark them off one by one. Go to the same distance across, do the same thing again, mark them off one by one, and then do something similar down the sides. Kind of work out the differences in sizes. A little bit more complicated for mine because I've got all these individual ones down the sides there. So three down, then I've got five down. So I've got to work that one out. But other than that, once you've got it all drawn out, we can start adding the paint in as well. And that's the enjoyable part, isn't it, when you start painting. So I'm going to get this drawn out and back with you in a minute. But you do this to whatever size that you would like, really. If you want it bigger, if you want it neater, you can do. In fact, for all these gaps in between the colours, which I'm going to draw, what you can is get a little bit of low-tack masking tape. This is washi tape. And cut off some very thin slits of that. Something like that there, for example. And you can use that as a gaps in between. So when it's all nice and dry, you can just take that masking tape off and you get some nice, crisp, clean edges as well. Okay, wow, that's all the lines drawn out. Now to fill it in. Now, I'll tell you what I'll do first. I'm going to write down the names in there first of all. So I'll start off with this one, which is Viridian Green. Indigo. Okay, see in a minute, we're going to get all these written out on the paper. First colours first, let's go for the Viridian Green. So that one there. Now this one, these are very slim little sections I'm going to paint on this one. Now get that brush a really good wash out before we go into the yellow. I've still got a little bit of green in there, look, from a previous painting I did. So this is Gambo Yellow, or Gambo Hue is the right way of saying it. And this is where we get the nice little squares. So you can fill this in properly, edge to edge. Make it as neat as you want it to be. As I said, I'm not too worried if it's not that neat. It's only for my reference at the end of the day. Now I've got to do the same now for all of these colours. So I'll see you in a minute when we've got all these colours on. Fine tuning the last one, which is lamp black. That'll do. So all I need to do now, let it dry and then you can cut it out to whatever size you want. And then cover it with some clear plastic. You can use sellotape, anything like that will work really, really well. In fact, I've got one which I made earlier. Ta-da, there it is. So it's exactly the same as you can see there. And that's one I've been using for a good, probably a couple of years now with my half pan paints. Okay, so that's my colour swatch for that one. As for the other one, which is Regina's Watercolours, so this one here, I don't want to get on that lamp black there. That's the colour swatch, which you get with those paints. And you can see straight away, even by looking at the colours here, the violet is much brighter, much clearer than it is within the half pans. The same applies to my Winsor & Newton paints. They can see straight away, look, if I just play that there. The phthalo blue, so that one there, is much darker again within the half pan block. And again, that's because it's really concentrated. So when I want to kind of make a colour reference towards a painting I'm working on, I can use this as a more accurate colour guide. So if you haven't got one of these, it might be worth you making one up, just as like a standby colour checker so you can compare it to the reference photo. At least that way you know, as I say, that the colour's going to be roughly about right on your kind of test piece here. All I've done, put a little bit of a card on the back, and then you can stand it up, and there we go. That's now ready to use. However, we're working with watercolours, aren't we? And because we're working with watercolours, different manufacturers, as I mentioned, have different names for very similar looking colours. I'll tell you what we'll do, we'll go on to that part next. Now, to give you a better understanding about the colours in question, when you look at these two colours here, this is intense blue or phthalo blue, same colour. And look how it works when it's really kind of creamy, then like a milky consistency and more obviously watery for the lower one. But that is obviously the same paint. And that's how it would look, obviously, when you're looking at your half pans as well. Now, please like, share, subscribe, and comment, as all these interactions encourage YouTube to show my content to even more people. Now, this in turn will allow my channel to grow and teach even more budding artists like yourself. To give you more of an understanding on that as well, so what we'll do, if I just get this piece of card I've got ready to go, just stick that down. My painting is nice and dry underneath, and because it's low tack tape, I can do this on this one. Okay, so let's put it over there. Get a bigger brush, and we'll go for a little bit of Scarlet Lake. So I'm going to show you a gradated feel to this and the way it kind of works. So working from one side with a more kind of creamy, richer mix. Something like that. A bit watery on there at the moment. It's going to get creamy as it goes along. There you go. Ooh. I'd only paint it so far. Something like that there. Look. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to get some water, and there's still a little bit of colour on this brush. That's fine. That's what I want. And add the water further along. While that's nice and wet. Okay. It's a little bit more down there. Get that blob of water off. There you go, that's better. And just cover this with water and let it soak into the paper that little bit. And then I'm going to catch that red paint, that Scarlet Lake. Look at that go. And drag it along, not too far. Maybe about two-thirds of the way, something like that there will do. And I'm going to wash that brush out. And then tickle this water into this edge again. Give it a tickle to get a nice kind of graduated wash. And sometimes it's easier if you have it on a board that's slanted. My board is actually on an angle here. And because of that, I can put it on that way around and allow it to flood down the paper. And you probably find it easier to kind of control that way as well. You can move it around, gently tweak it and twist it. And as it starts to dry, then you leave it alone, let it dry normally, or give it a quick blast with a hairdryer. Then you get yourself a nice kind of gradated colour to work with when you're trying to work out the colours as well within a painting. So when you're kind of comparing this to a reference photograph, you can cut this out, which I'll show you in a minute when it's dry, and then you can match it up to a photo and see which part of this colour you prefer to use, especially if you're working with skin tones and things like that. And that's quite good with alizarin crimson as well. Okay, I'm going to give it a quick dry, then we'll cut it out. Now it's just about dry, so just take off this tape now. So what's good about using low-tack masking tape is that you can remove it and then reuse this as well. Sometimes I put it to one side and then I'll save that for another little job later on. Okay, let's get a big pair of scissors and we'll cut along the edge of this. So that will give us some ideas what you can do when you're working on a painting. So I would do this smaller, because if you got this in a smaller size, so I've just been playing with one here, look, that kind of size there, a little bit of French ultramarine. And at least that way, when you cut them out to the edge like that, you can just offer that up to your reference photograph and work out the kind of tonal value. This is just one colour, don't forget. And if you've got a whole assortment of colours within your kind of painting kit, you can do quite a few of these, as I say, quite a lot smaller, of course, and work out roughly the tone that you'll need to kind of get that part of that flower. So if you've got a real pale area on one of the petals, you can work on that section there. Okay, oh, I've got quite a bit of water for that one, but that's a colour that you're going to work with. So that's a good way of kind of testing out and working out roughly what colours you'll need and the kind of consistency that that colour will need to be. So, to give you some ideas on using scrap pieces of watercolour paper, and this is that graduated wash, so it's all gradated all the way through, from the darkest or the richest of the colour, so thicker pigment, all the way through to the lightest kind of coloured wash. Now I can match these up if I want to. Let's have a quick look at a photograph. And we'll go for the bee eater, okay? So if I can put that down there without it sliding everywhere, to give us some general idea, I can then, let's say for example, let's have a look at the back of the bee eater, so that area there, look. We can now, using this, try and hold the tablet in place there, using this, let's use those two colours there for example. The yellow ochre is very similar to this area here, and the burnt sienna is also very similar to some of the richest tones that we can see within the back. So that mixed with a little bit of brown would work quite well. This mixed with a little bit of yellow, lemon yellow, will probably work quite well as well. So matching up something like that and working out the tonal variations within the photograph and thinking how kind of much water do I need to add into that? And this will give you some really good indication on how that all works. Okay, so that would give us some ideas on how to kind of offer that up, something like this, to your reference photograph. So there's a nice little tip for you there. But when you look at something like this, I know it's going to be a whole array of colours, isn't it? So many colours will need mixing. I'll tell you what, I've got another little video on how to do that. So pop a little card up in the corner there for you. And of course, with the bee eater I've just shown you, the bee eater painting, I didn't do them with Winsor & Newton paints. I actually did them with the Regina's paints. So I would use my colour strips like this to compare my colours to Regina's colours and working out which ones I've got similar to the ones that she uses. Okay, so a little tip for you, well worth doing this. And of course, if you fancy painting that very colourful bee eater I've just shown you, I'll pop a little card in the corner for you so you can have a look at that later on. So what you can do, when you make up little strips of colours like this, and these are all obviously gradated, so from the kind of richest tone, or the really thicker version of the colour, and just adding more water down to the lightest end of the spectrum really for that one colour. So make an array of these, as you can see you've got quite a few here, look going. And do this with all of the colours that you got within your, well, watercolour selection. Be it the half pans like that, or be it the tube paints, or in fact, everything that you've got. And then if you've got probably a couple of these, two or three of these at hand, you can then match these up to the photograph you're working from. In fact, to be honest with you, if you're working from a video tutorial from an artist who is using different watercolours to you, okay, so if you're following one of my videos on my website on how to paint, I don't know, like this bee eater or something like that, then you might think, well, I've only got Sennelier paints or, you know, White Knights or De La Rowney or whatever different manufacturers are out there. How do I know which colours are going to be very similar to Paul's colours for his Winsor & Newton versions? What you want to do is when you've got these little strips like this, you can match them up along the way to my colours, the way I've got them on the website or on the page, or the downloadable PDFs which I provide. But when you're working with, let's say for example, the one I did for the BET was with Regina's watercolours. And these are her colours here, or just some of her colours here, like, for the foundation colours. Now, this is her poppy red, which is that one there. As you can see, it's very, very bright red, which is that one. And I know that from my colour collection, my Scarlet Lake is very similar. Okay, very, very similar colour. And then we've got, what am I going to tell you about? Oh yeah, Blueprint, which is this one here. Look at that, it's a lovely colour, isn't it? That's also very similar, if I can get the colour out, to my French Ultramarine. See that? And then you go down to the lightest end, and you can see that's very similar down there as well. And then, let's do one more, I was going to mention. Daffodil. That's a nice colour, isn't it, Daffodil? What a lovely name that is. Now I can go to Daffodil, and then match up my other colour. This is another yellow one, lemon yellow. I've got a variety of yellow colours knocking about I can test out. But you can see this is very similar to lemon yellow. So I could use this colour instead. You just have to remember as well that the way you see things on a computer screen or a tablet like this may be a little bit different, because it depends how your tablet or computer screen shows you the colours. It might be a bit over bright, a bit over colourful. So just bear that in mind when you're working with it. So you don't have to be precise, not really exactly precise. As long as it's similar or near enough, that's all you got to bear in mind. So check the manufacturer's colour guides that you're trying to do the painting from and just see what they're like. In fact, go on your own manufacturer's colour guide. So if you're Winsor & Newton, you find on the Winsor & Newton website there'll be a downloadable kind of document you can use for the colours, so you can compare colours to other people that way around. And also, for just about every website there is, there'll be a colour chart you can download in some shape or form. So it's well worth checking with the kind of paints that you've got on the manufacturer's website, you can get a colour chart for your brand of paints. Now let me know in the comments down below which watercolour swatches that you found most useful. I'll also put down there the colour chart links for the Winsor & Newton Professional and Cotman range, and not forgetting a link to Regina's watercolours as well. Now have a look to my left, or in your case your right, for the BET video which I've been talking about. And within that video, again go to that description area down below, where you'll be able to download the reference photograph, the outline drawing, and even a little PDF on the colours and materials which I use for that video. I'll see you there.